Everybody ready?
Ready?
Yeah.
All right, listen.
It's your weekend show.
Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
With Bob Biermann.
It's great.
And welcome to your weekend show. I'm your host, Bob Biermann. I'm so glad you're taking some time from your busy weekend schedule to spend it with me. I've enjoyed doing the last couple of weekends of programs. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about time and how precious time is and how it can slip away and how when time is spent, you don't get it back. And last weekend, I had the opportunity of being a bit of a disc jockey again. I enjoy doing that from time to time. The reaction those kind of programs get when I play some music from years gone by seems to generate a good amount of email and response. And so from time to time, we will do a program where we play some music from a certain time and era and style to bring back some memories. I recognize because of the medium that we are on shortwave radio. And think about this for a minute. I'm sitting in front of a microphone that takes my voice and converts it to an electronic impulse that is amplified, processed, and then recorded and mixed with other sources like music and everything else that puts together a radio program. And this recording, this digital recording, is then sent to radio stations and even to online venues for you to hear. And the technology that makes all this happen occurred in less than 100 years' time in our world today. I enjoy the emails that I get and your ideas and thoughts about this radio program week in and week out. And right here at the top of the program, while I have a moment before I forget, we do have a website, yourweekendashow.com. That is yourweekendashow.com, a great place to find out about the program, what we do, even can find some of the more recent episodes in our archive page, and you can hear them again if you'd like, or even download them to listen to at your convenience, and also where you can hear the program, all from yourweekendashow.com. And of course, you can email me directly. These emails come to me, nobody else. And you can tell me your thoughts about your weekend show, and I love to hear from you. That is yourweekendshow.com. And occasionally I hear from people on Facebook. We do maintain a Facebook presence week in and week out. And just search for Your Weekend Show. And if you make Your Weekend Show one word, you find it right away. So look for us at yourweekendshow.com. Or on Facebook, just look for Your Weekend Show. These past couple of weeks, I've been thinking about time. It just seems to be on my mind because time can slip away so quick. And I want to make sure that I'm using my time, and I'm hoping you're using the time that you have, because we never do have a guarantee of just how much time we might have. I was thinking last weekend in particular, as I'm bringing back some musical memories, and it takes me back, some of these songs, to when I started out on the radio in around 1970-ish, where I started my radio career with the idea of being a disc jockey. And I can remember so many songs that I heard on the radio in the 1960s and played as I started out on the radio. Actually playing records, not compact disc or a digital recording. These were actual 45 RPM records, or in some cases even a record album, a 33 and a third. And I remember those days well, and I thought even then, what great technology we have to take this record and play it on a big turntable. And it comes through a mixing board, then to all the things that are required afterward, and onto a transmitter, and then onto a radio where somebody either at home or at work or in their car could hear that record that I am playing and the things that I'm saying in a microphone. I was blessed to be born at a time where technology had already been exploding within 40 years before I was born. I think of when my father was born in the 1920s and what life was like for him in the early days of his life. I mean, when my dad was born, radio was just beginning. Many homes, actually most homes, didn't have a radio set yet around 1925, but my dad did. He had one in their home. He remembers it well. He remembers his first personal radio that he ever had as a young man in the early 1930s. They called it a cat whisker radio. It's a mined piece of quartz along with a coil and some headphones, and you attached it to a piece of wire and you grounded it to your plumbing in the house, your cast iron plumbing, and you could pick out radio stations in those early days. His parents, my grandparents, who I knew quite well, who lived well into their 90s, and they only passed away in the 1990s, remember a time when there was no radio. They lived with the early days of electricity, the first telephones coming into homes on a regular basis, like we started to see over those years. And they saw the first radios come online even before my dad was born. My father would tell me that he thought that how much more could technology ever grow from what he saw as a young boy? I mean, airplanes with multiple engines, radio, electricity, refrigeration, so you could actually have a refrigerator, not an ice box, in your home. The automobile was commonplace, and people traveled by car to go shopping, to go to work, to even take a vacation. In just a matter of a handful of years, we went from horse and buggy, no refrigeration, no electricity, no radio, to a time when we had all these new things at our fingertips. And in my dad's younger years, and when he served in the Second World War, he had just come through the Great Depression, and he remembers listening at night to the radio as a kid. He himself got into electronics for a number of years and served in the United States Marines during the Second World War and used what he had learned actually in a combat environment. Nuclear energy came of age during the Second World War, the atomic bomb, and then all the electrical generation that came just a decade or so after. My father got to watch the experimental television at the World's Fair in New York, seeing what would be television. All that occurred in just such a short amount of time between 1900 and the 1930s. We had radio and the beginnings of what would become television. We had motion pictures. Think about all these wonderful things that they were finding on a daily basis in their lives there. In the 1920s, 1930s, 1940s, and by the 1950s, we had television. Television had been sidetracked because of the Second World War. But by 1948, television stations are coming on the air in the big cities and gradually working their way across the United States. And radio, that had been the primary source of communications and entertainment and news and you name it, was beginning to take a second seat. And people even predicted, you know, radio would be over. But radio reinvented itself and became mobile and portable. And radio survived. And no longer did you have the radio dramas by the end of the 1950s. You had music formats and information formats and community news formats. Radio still reaches about 93% of the population of the United States each and every week. And in my lifetime, I've watched television go from black and white to color. FM radio came of age, even started broadcasting in FM stereo in my lifetime. Record recordings went from mono to stereo, and we thought that how much could we improve in our lifetime? We would see the house of the future and all these robots and machines and things to do for us, the flying car, all these things were out there to tantalize us, but they seem like, who needed it? Honestly, who did? I remember when I graduated high school in 1972, and I had decided, rather than going the regular track to a four-year university, which a lot of people did, it was also very commonplace for young men to consider going to a two-year trade school to learn a skill, a marketable, usable skill that could provide you a decent living. And I traveled from where I lived in upstate New York to near Akron, Ohio, Cuyahoga Falls to be exact, and I attended an electronics school where I learned the ins and outs of radio and amplifiers and control systems and even television sets. I could have made a choice at that point in time to be a TV repairman or learn what I really wanted to learn is to be a broadcast engineer because radio fascinated me. Even more so than television. And I thought to be a person that could be on the radio, which I was doing at that time, and to understand how these big transmitters worked in the studios and all the components, I figured for me that could be a lifetime ambition. I'd really thought about being nothing more than a radio announcer at many a time. It seemed like a lot of fun, and I thought that I would be a radio announcer to the day that I retired, working the top 40 formats, and as I got older, do middle of the road, then maybe nostalgia, whatever the case may be, and just follow the music. But that changed too, because once again, technology marched on in ways that none of us could have ever envisioned. I remember in the 1980s, you went into a radio station, you still had live announcers on the radio. Things had changed a little bit. A lot of radio stations stopped using turntables and began using recording devices, tape recordings, and then the compact disc came along. We had heard about computers. I had played with some early basic computers in the late 70s and early 1980s, and I really never saw at that time an application in the broadcast industry for the computers of that day. Until one day, about 1985, a guy came by a radio station that I was working at. I was doing engineering and a little bit of on-air work. I had left where I had been working, a manufacturer of broadcast equipment. My wife had some health issues, and I decided to get to an easier place for a while. And this guy came in, and he had this very basic DOS computer. I think it had like a 20-megabyte hard drive. Not a whole lot to write home about. That was a big deal. This hard drive was about the size of a shoebox inside this massive computer. And it had a new thing called a mouse. And yes, the screen was definitely a black and white, or in this case, I think, amber and black screen. And this program did something that nobody could ever envision just a couple of years before. It could record sound, and right there on the screen, you could edit that sound instead of cutting up tape like we used to with a razor blade and tape and literally like a scotch tape, or it's actually a splicing tape to piece our things together. Now you could do it on a screen and save it and then export it to any which way you wanted to play it. Oh, those devices were extremely expensive. This computer with that software, I think, was over $10,000 or more dollars at that time. And it could only do a few minutes of recording at a time because of storage space. And I knew then there's a future for computers. We were beginning to see applications for office software. In other words, for doing things like billing, and doing program logs and correspondence and letters and accounting. Those are beginning to come our way in the 1980s. But I never saw how a computer would really interact in a radio station until maybe about a few years later. 1989, I saw one of the first computers out there that could automate a radio station. Now, we had had radio automation before, where you had a couple of hours walk-away time. That was great for the AM-FM radio station, where you had a live announcer, let's say, on the AM station, and you had some kind of a light rock or beautiful music format on the FM, and the one announcer could run the two radio stations by getting up and changing reel-to-reels and inserting these special cartridge tapes for commercials and setting up the next hour or two in a few minutes' time. But this computer could do a lot more. Now, there were some computers that were built to actually operate these tape machine-based devices, but the game really changed when the recording was on the computer instead of an external recording. Walk-away time, instead of being an hour or two, could become a day or two. The early units, the audio quality was fair because of sampling rates and storage. But over the next several years, that improved dramatically as we got into the 1990s, and certain compression algorithms made it possible to have hard drives that could have hours of recorded information. And today, we have computers that can hold thousands upon thousands of hours of music and programs and play them on the air faithfully. By the late 1990s, the technology changed where you could have an announcer that could record everything that he needed to say as a disc jockey in a matter of 15 or 20 minutes, and he could do this for two or three or four radio stations. And the computer then would put together the music, the commercials, and everything that you inserted and play it at the appropriate time. And the technology just keeps advancing and marching forward. When I started out in radio in 1970, I could never have imagined the technology that we have today. The technology we have today at our fingertips. And I have to wonder, in 5, 10, 15, or 20 years, where that technology will take us in this industry. What will this industry of radio see in its future? In the United States, and I'm going to say something here real quick, and I'm just going to give you my opinion as a broadcast engineer. You may differ, and you're welcome to. In the United States, we've adopted years ago the concept of high-definition broadcasting, HD radio. This is a digital format that can share the space with your regular analog FM and even AM. Not that many use it for AM, but they could use it on FM, and you could add even extra audio channels without them being analog, like the old subcarrier stuff was, if you know radio like I do. And suddenly you can have an FM radio station that has one, two, or three radio stations all buried together on one channel. And as great of a system as it is, it's not as good as some of the other systems that have been developed around the world that you see in India or Europe, where they have DRM radio, they have true digital, and the frequencies are set aside for digital radio. I think the United States may have made a mistake with a system not as good as we see used internationally. And of course, as many of you know and listen, this program is on international shortwave. And I really see the day when many of our broadcasts on shortwave will be digital, not always analog. Now, analog has its place for long-distance reception because even in the static and noise, you can hear something. Digital, if you have enough signal coming in, you've got a clean signal. When it gets weak, it begins to break up and then disappear. So there is a plus side and a negative for digital. Yes, it's clear. It sounds better. You can add additional information like song titles and what have you to display on your little radio screen. And I really believe the future of a lot of shortwave stations is going to be the ability of using DRM, using a digital carrier. But I do believe that analog will never 100% disappear, at least no time soon. But technology may beat us to the punch yet, as it has more often than not. And so we try to adapt your weekend show. This program is recorded in stereo with a decent enough fidelity to be good enough for better than FM. I try to keep it right at CD quality. And I really see the day that even on international shortwave, you'll be able to hear this program in a higher fidelity, in stereo, and really be immersed in the program when that happens. Yet I do enjoy when I travel and the program is on, let's say, WRMI and from time to time some other stations, to actually hear it on shortwave. Sometimes it's loud and clear. Sometimes there's a little bit of noise in the background. But the signal's ever there. Radio, the real secret about radio, and I think what many of the operators today miss, radio can be one of the greatest one-on-one mediums out there. I learned when I first got on the air, my first radio station that I was paid. Now, I will admit, the statute of limitations has run out, so the couple of years in high school that I ran a pirate AM and a pirate FM are long behind me by a factor of almost 50 years, so I don't think there's a problem now. But as I first got on the air in around 1971, I remember this program director at WACK. His name was Gary Van. Real name was Gary Van Vechten. And he had a great radio voice and understood the business like no man I ever saw. And why he wanted to work in a small market like he did for all those years is beyond me. I think he just enjoyed it. But he always reminded me, never use the term radio land. He hated that term. To all you ladies and gentlemen out in radio land. He said what you need to do is always imagine when you're behind the microphone, you're talking to your best friend or someone you're trying to get to know better. And you want to share with them your day. You want to share with them information that they need. And you want to provide for them the music that they love. And if you communicate with them and you become their electronic friend, that voice in a radio speaker that they know and that they trust, they'll miss you when you're not there. And if you ever leave the station, they will really believe you're doing everything you're doing on the air for them, and they'll even tolerate the commercials that you play. And if they really like you and you get good enough, when you do a live commercial and talk about something that's really something they need to hear about, it becomes believable, especially if you believe in that product. Because let's face it, here's one little thing about radio that needs to be said right now. I read a lot of email where someone says, I wish this station on shortwave would just play this kind of music or do this or that or the other. Well, that's well and good in a, quote, utopian world, but every month there is bills to pay, like electricity, and it's huge, those bills in shortwave. These are bills that are not a few hundred dollars a month. They're multiplied thousands of dollars a month per transmitter. You have massive antenna systems that need to be maintained, transmitters that need to be repaired and maintained, and tubes that have to be replaced. It is a very expensive proposition to operate an international shortwave radio station. It's not free. And while maybe you want to hear classical music, or maybe you want to hear classic country or top 40 rock and roll or jazz or whatever the case may be, at some point, someone's got to write the check to the power company, to those that work on the equipment, to taxes and insurance and you name it. Everything else that comes along in operating any kind of a business, because unfortunately, whether we like it or not, you know, with one of the radio stations I spent a lot of time with, WRMI, there's no government check coming in for us to just play radio to make people happy. I know that some of these stations, they try to balance programming to pay the bills, and try to provide some things like your weekend show that may be of interest. And so it's never easy to do. But I'm thankful for the time that I have each and every week to share with you the thoughts that are on my heart and my mind, and to look back over the years to see how life has changed, how technologies move forward. But you know, when it comes down to the bottom line, we are still people. The only thing that I think has been sad that I've seen in my lifetime, in the United States in particular, dare I say it, I don't want to sound political. I try to avoid that, as you know, on this program, but I have to say it. Somewhere along the way, we have gradually lost common sense. I was thinking the other day, as I look at some young people getting ready to graduate high school or go on to college or whatever the case may be, so many of them today are ill-equipped to really care for themselves and take care of the basic needs of life. I graduated high school at 17, loaded up the car and headed off to another state to support myself, to have a job, and go to school. I knew how to cook on a stove. We didn't have a microwave oven yet. And I certainly didn't have the money to eat out at any of the fast food joints that were nowhere near as noticeable as they are today. When I came along, having a McDonald's in your town was a big deal. Now they're on every street corner. When I came along, I was content in my first little apartment by myself, my second place that I lived at. Are you ready for this? To have a tiny little refrigerator and a hot plate. That's how I fed myself. And I learned how to cook. I didn't buy TV dinners, which then still required a half hour or better in an oven. I learned how to use pots and pans. When things broke on the car, you learn how to get tools out to fix it. Cars today are very reliable, but they're also disposable because there's so many things you really can't do on them anymore. They do last a long time. There's no doubt about that. That's the good side. I meet people today in their 20s that the simple things of house repair, they've never learned. Common sense has become a lost commodity. And it troubles me at times that my generation somehow failed our kids, who are now increasingly, and many times, not all, trust me, not all, fail theirs. Now, thankfully, I've got a daughter that lives over on the other coast of Florida, who has been self-sufficient since she was before the age of 16. She knew how to take care of herself, and she has been able to do that all her life. And her daughter, my granddaughter, both of her daughters, are highly motivated individuals that can take care of business and do the things they have to do. And they're really not dependent upon anybody. They've learned how to use that gift that God gave them called common sense. They didn't chuck it by the wayside. They didn't ignore it. They didn't throw it away. And maybe that's something we need to restore in the generations coming forward. If we as a society are going to survive, we need to respect two things: common sense and wisdom. And the definition that I've always had of wisdom is knowledge that has been tested by experience. Let me say that again. Wisdom is knowledge that has been tested by experience. I can have a head full of book learning, as we called it back in our day, but until I can apply that book knowledge, what good is it? Through experience, through living life, and sorting it out, you can learn the basics of common sense. Common sense that tells you to come inside when it's raining, not to go at a high speed in your car when it's snowy. And it's amazing how many people have lost sight of things as simple as that because they believe technology repairs all. Well, this is your weekend show, and I'm your host, Bob Biermann. Once again, our website is yourweekendshow.com. That is yourweekendshow.com. And maybe if you can find a few minutes this coming week, today, tomorrow, why not drop me an email and let me know that you listen to the program? This is a program about life, and in a few minutes I'm going to share some additional thoughts about life and how to make the best when things are broken, too. You know, I have learned we all make mistakes, and things happen that we let happen, sometimes not intentionally, but at some point the repairs have got to be made, and I'm going to share a few things personally about that in just a few minutes. Once again, you are listening to your weekend show, and I'm your host, Bob Bureau.
We were born to mothers who smoked and drank. Our cribs were covered in lead-based paint. No child-proof lids, no seatbelts in cars. Rode bikes with no helmets, and still here we are. Still here we are. We got daddy's belt when we misbehave. Had three TV channels, you got up to change. No video games and no satellite. All we had were friends and they were outside. Playing outside. It was a different life when we were boys and girls. Not just a different time. It was a different world. School always started the same every day. The Pledge of Allegiance, then someone would pray. Not every kid made the team when they tried. We got disappointed, but that was alright. We turned out alright. It was a different life when we were boys and girls. Not just a different time. It was a different world. No bottom water.
Covington and A Different World. And for those that listen to this program on a regular basis, yes, I know I played it just, a couple of weeks or so ago. I still like the song, and I thought it would make a great transition to this next part of the program today. Yeah, I do remember those kind of days when we didn't have seatbelts in cars. I didn't wear a helmet to ride my bicycle. Living in Long Island, where there was a thing when they called them a sump. They were like a hole dug in the ground for water runoff. And in the wintertime, they were great places to ride a sled. Even though you weren't supposed to, we did it anyway. Like a lot of kids did a lot of things back in those days you really weren't supposed to do. but even the authorities generally looked the other way. It was a different world. Kids played outdoors. Parents were more trusting, even in an urban environment like Long Island. Nobody worried too much when the sun went down, especially in the wintertime when it went down around 4:30 and dinner wasn't until 6. We were outside in the dark and the cold playing. Even in upstate New York, when I moved there right before I entered high school, we stayed out till all kinds of hours, but somehow we still got the homework done. A lot of kids don't seem to have much of that anymore. We had a lot of responsibility and things that we were supposed to do back in those days. Yeah, it was a different time, and it was a different world. And sometimes, and I know I sound a little bit nostalgic here, sometimes I think the kids today don't have near the opportunity to be themselves and to truly learn things that'll carry them through life that we did 40 years ago, 50 years ago, half a century ago. We learned to be more dependent upon doing certain things. And now, because of technology, maybe this is the downside. We have a lot of kids that know how to do things on a phone or on a keyboard, but they can't function with the real tools of life. And I know too many that are in their younger teens in particular that cannot differentiate between the real world and a virtual world. They haven't learned yet that life does not have an automatic reset button to start over certain things. You have to deal with life where you're at moving forward. And oftentimes, decisions we make today can profoundly affect us 5, 10, even 50 years down the road. And a lot of kids today have never learned the idea of a consequence. And sadly, they'll have a hard time when they begin their life. Well, enough being on the soapbox for the moment. I do want to share a thought that's on my mind. I kind of alluded to this a couple of weeks ago. There are times, and I found myself in the same boat. Things happen to us in life. As we get older, as we move on, as we go through the changes and chances of this world, sometimes we lose touch with people that meant a lot to us in another time, in another place. Now, it's normal, you know, and I know if you're my age, that there are a lot of people we knew in high school that after we left high school, we rapidly lost touch. Maybe you went to a 20th high school reunion like I did, and you meet a few of them again, and I haven't seen a lot of those people since 1992. That's a natural thing as you move on and get married and start a family and maybe move to another part of the country to follow your dreams and what have you. It is one of those sad but true realities that sometimes we lose touch with some of our family and some of our friends. And then there are times that, because of circumstances that were beyond our control, we also can lose touch with people that mean so much. And you wake up one day and realize 5 years have gone by, 10 years have gone by, and you're almost afraid to reestablish contact. Maybe they've changed. Maybe they're mad at you. Maybe they felt abandoned, and you just don't want to open up a sore wound. I faced that not too long ago. After my first wife died in 2004, now, for those that have listened to the program, you'll know that I married a gal a little bit older than I was way back in 75, and she already had two daughters, and one in particular was younger, so I was the dad in the house for many years, and I watched those kids grow up. I watched grandchildren being born, and now there are great-grandchildren that have been born since that time. But when my wife first took ill back in the early 2000s, and I lost her in 2004, I was like a lot of men, very lonely, hurting, and confused. And even though I had been trained as a hospice chaplain, did that for a number of years, I made every mistake a person that has lost a loved one can do. Making life-changing decisions in that first year you shouldn't be making. And as a result, I moved on to another life, so to speak, and gradually, not intentionally, but gradually began to lose touch with my own stepdaughters, which meant I also lost touch with my grandchildren. Several years back, it began to weigh heavy on my mind, and I thought, I need to do something about this, but I was increasingly, like many people are, maybe you've been there yourself, you're almost afraid to make contact. Maybe they're mad at you. Maybe they feel rejected, and like I say, you're just opening up an old wound. My wife now has encouraged me in no uncertain terms to do something about that, to begin to repair that breach. So maybe Facebook actually does have a redeeming value or two. And I was able to connect with a couple of the grandkids at first on Facebook. And they hadn't forgotten me. And so for a couple of years, on occasion, we share a few posts and pictures back and forth. But getting to the point of being able to talk again to one daughter in particular, who does not do Facebook, she's just not that kind of a person. And I've been afraid to call, didn't have the number, lost track of it. Because of my granddaughter opening the doorway. A few weeks ago, I made a little trip. Left on a Thursday, came back on a Friday night. And I traveled from my home in Port St. Lucie to the other coast of Florida. It's about a 2.5 hour, 3 hour drive away. And spent the afternoon, evening, and the next day with a daughter that I hadn't talked to in 10 years. It was wonderful. You know, the years melted away so suddenly. And you realize that those family bonds you created over 30-some-odd years were still as strong today as they were back then. About the same time, right before I went there, I talked about time and how precious it was. How precious time is, and you don't get it back. And so every day I didn't repair that problem was another day that I lost out, that I can't get back. One by one, by God's grace, I have gotten my family back while at the same time being married to a wonderful woman and also creating new aspects and memories in my life to make it full and complete. The work that I do in ministry, the work I do in radio, and the family that I have, my extended family, is probably my greatest asset and blessing. It means more than money. It means everything to me. And I want to urge you, if you have lost touch with somebody that meant something so important to you, maybe it's time to reconnect. You know, in these past 4 or 5 years, I've reconnected with people and friends that I had lost touch with for 10, 20, even 40 years. And they have been a great help to me and I to them, because we knew each other way back when and what each of us could be. And in our time to talk and share, we've helped each other in this life's journey. Don't try to take life all by yourself the hard way. There's no reason to. Human beings are designed to be social beings. We're really not meant to be loners at heart. And I think we miss out so much on life when we don't interact with other people. People of like-mindedness, people that are family, people that are friends, people that would do anything for you as I would for them. And so I would urge you in the most powerful way, if you've lost connection with somebody, a very significant part of your life, while it's not easy, you need to start working on that as your new project. And if you're like me, you will not regret it. And you'll be so thankful and so fulfilled because of it. Enough of being on the soapbox for the moment. As I think back over the years, the places that I've been, I think I said a week or two ago that life is a sequence of memories that we make. And if all we're doing is waiting for the alarm clock to go to work and try to get through life to pay bills, and we don't find any satisfaction really in the work that we do, it's just to exist, you're missing out on so much of what life has to offer. And I hope that you'll take what I'm saying to heart and not let your family and those that were close to you ever get away from you. This is your weekend show, and I'm your host, Bob Bierman. Once again, the website, yourweekendshow.com, yourweekendshow.com, and you can find us on Facebook. Simply look for Your Weekend Show. Make that all one word, Your Weekend Show, and guess what? You find us right away. This is a program about the journey of life, the shared experience that you and I have the opportunity to go through together. And as I share from my heart to yours, I hope that it has meaning for you. There's so many things that can happen to each and every one of us. We don't know if bad things will happen in our life. I know people that I've known for years that suddenly have a health issue that compromises them. They didn't see it coming. There was no warning. None of us know how many days, hours, years, or minutes, or seconds we have in this world. The key is to make full use of the time that we are given. Many of us may live to be 80 or 90 or maybe even a centurion. And others of us may not. My late wife, I believe she would have lived to be in her mid-80s or pushing 90. And she was in her early 60s when she died from a disease she never anticipated having. She worried because of her family history about potential heart issues later in life, and she took such good care of herself, only to be struck down by something else. Don't take the days, the minutes, the hours, the weeks, the months, and the years we have for granted. Would you please make good use of your time?
We've only just begun to live. White lace and promises. A kiss for luck and we're on our way.
Along the way.
Oh.
place where there's room to grow.
And yes, we've just begun.
Karen and Richard Carpenter, and We've Only Just Begun. I remember playing that song when it came out in 1975. It was the year that I only had just begun to live, when I first got married in 75. And I remember that time so well, and I hope that maybe if you're my age and you can remember those days, hopefully they're bringing back some fond memories of starting out a new life. Trying to acquire the things you need in life, you know, the roof over your head, that first decent color TV set was a big deal. Trying to keep the cars running and food on the table. And all the responsibilities of starting a new life and taking on all the responsibilities of life suddenly, in a matter of a few years from the time that you left home, as you both begin a career, and you adapt your life into living with somebody else, and all the responsibility that comes along with paying the bills. Something I think we've not really taught our young people today, how to really look at their resources, their job, and their money. I remember the one thing I can tell you is that when I first started out in 1975, I didn't have a credit card. And we rarely borrowed any money. We had a mortgage on a house. And for a very short time, because we planned for it carefully, we had payments for about 9 months on a new television. I remember the TV set well. It was a Magnavox 25-inch, I remember. I think it was 25, may have been 23, 25-inch color TV set in a beautiful early American wood cabinet that my wife just loved the cabinet. I just loved the fact that it was a color TV set. And I remember for 9 months we made this very painful $60 a month payment for that television set. Because we had put down almost $200 and some odd that we had saved up to buy the set. And we even got it on a bank loan, not a finance company. It was actually the Bank of Toccoa in Toccoa, Georgia, that financed $400 and some odd in change. And we had paid the down payment and all the tax up front. We had that television set for a long, long time. Bought it in 1975, and I think we finally retired it in 1991. That's a long time to have one television set. And the set ran faithfully for years. Eventually, we had a car payment on occasion, but for the most part, we always bought a second-hand car. I was always blessed to have some family and friends that knew people that were selling cars, and many of the cars that I purchased, I bought directly from an individual to save money. And my wife was pretty good about saving a few dollars aside that I didn't even know about. And so when a car began to act up, she would say, well, you know, I have some money we can get a car with if we can just get rid of ours and trade it in or sell it. And sometimes we take out a short-term one-year loan to make up the difference because we decided it was cheaper than the repair bill we might have on a car. You make these kind of decisions. Today, too many young people start out with credit cards, and before they know it, they're $5, $10, $15, $20,000 in debt. They go to college today, and they rake up debts that are in the six figures, and oftentimes getting into degrees that don't really pay anything, which is deeply concerning. You know, I remember when I went to college, especially when I went to trade school, I could afford that out of what I was being paid in my virtually minimum wage job at a radio station. I'd live lean. I didn't go out to the movies. I didn't eat out much, almost never. I learned how to live on a lot of, you know, macaroni and cheese and hamburger patties and simple fare, because I had that weekly rent to pay. I had gas to put in the car and hope the tires and engine and everything hold together. And, you know, I look back at those years. It wasn't easy when I first got married, doing the same thing, but having the responsibility of other people depending upon me to do all the things that I had to do. You want to know something? I wouldn't trade those moments in for anything in the world, even the difficult times, when you wondered how you were going to make the two ends meet. But that's the experience that life is. And even in the difficult times, you can always find the good. And I thank God and bless that I was able to do that in my life. This is your weekend show, and I'm your host, Bob Bierman.
If I could save time in a bottle, the first thing that I'd like to do is to save every day till eternity passes away, just to spend them with you. If I could make days last forever, if words could make wishes come true, I'd save every day like a treasure, and then again I would spend them with you. But there never seems to be enough time to do the things you want to do once you find them. Looked around enough to know that you're the one I want to go through time with. If I had a box just for wishes and dreams that had never come true, the box would be empty except for the memory of how they were answered by you. But there never seems to be enough time to do the things you want to do once you find them. I've looked around enough to know you're the one I want to go through time.
Jim Croce and Time in a Bottle here on your weekend show. You know, I can't believe the time has escaped me once again. This hour is just come and gone. Don't forget the website, yourweekendtoshow.com, yourweekendtoshow.com. Send me an email if you get a chance. Visit our Facebook page also at Your Weekend Show. Look for Your Weekend Show. Don't take time for granted. Use it. Till next week, may God richly bless you.